제가 4강 간 다음 좋은 성적을 좀 내고 바로 다음 시즌이었는데 성적이 생각만큼 많이 안 나왔어요. 그런 부분에서 느끼는 점이 되게 많았고 같은 실수하지 않고 더 잘하는 게 좋을 것 같아요.
올해 들어서 GSL 코넷은 이제 처음 예선 찍었는데 그동안 항상 마지막에 이렇게 마지막 세트까지 가서 져가지고 아쉬움이 많이 남았었는데 이번 기회만큼은 놓치고 싶지 않네요.
I guess now it doesn't feel like special. It doesn't feel like a new thing that I've qualified. It feels like something I keep playing in and I want to do better in. And I think this time I've put in the most work beforehand. So even though it's a hard group, like I want to advance more than ever. Because I lost the first round of the last two. So.
실력이 없다 보니까 이제 16강에서 좀 아쉽게 탈락을 했는데 이번 시즌에는 좀 연습량도 많이 늘었고 세태전 이제 개념도 좀 잡혀가는 단계여가지고 저번 시즌보다는 더 잘할 수 있을 것 같아요.
우리 조를 보고 쉽지 않겠다 생각은 했었는데 뭐 다른 조 다 보고 나니까 거기서 다 거기더라고요. 그래서 그래도 할만하겠다, 뭐 내가 하기 나름이겠다 이런 생각을 했어요.
제일 만나기 싫은 선수 중 한 명인 이노베이션 선수가 있어서 좀 역시 코드에서 32강부터 힘들구나 라는 생각을 했지만 스칼렛 선수는 최근에 좀 이겨봤고 또 요새 토스전을 좀 힘들어하는 것 같아서 좀 그나마 가능성이 있겠다는 생각이 들긴 했어요.
I actually think this time is my hardest group so far of all the seasons I've played in. This is the first time I wasn't seed for one of my group, but I still have to play Innovation first, so that's unfortunate. But recently I think I've been playing pretty well. So even though it's a very hard group, I think there's a chance I can get through.
전체적으로 쉽더라고요, 이번에 32강이. 그래서 괜찮은 것 같고, 저희 조도 나름 변수는 있을 수 있겠지만, 웬만하면 무난하게 올라가지 않을까 싶어요.
꼭 우승하고 싶어요 이번 시즌. 전 시즌에 병재가 우승하는 걸 보고 많은 게이머들이 아 나도 할 수 있겠구나를 생각했을 것 같고 그만큼 또 이번 시즌에서 그 선수들이 좋은 경기력 보여주고 그런다면 그 속에서 꼭 우승을 하고 싶어요.
항상 GSL은 제가 되게 패기 넘치게 말하고 나서 항상 32강에서 떨어지고 32강의 벽을 넘지 못했었거든요. 그래서 이번 시즌은 32강에서만큼은 꼭 이기도록 하겠습니다.
I don't think there's a specific reason why I play in GSL. I enjoy that it's a Korean competition and it's very different from what I've played before. And I do like living in Korea, so that allows me to. And I think pretty much any player would if they were living in Korea.
말로는 안정권이라고 하는데 그래도 변수가 아직 있으니까 마지막 시즌 좀 잘 해가지고 안정적으로 블리츠강 꼭 가고 싶네요.
2017 Hot 6 GSL Season 3 CODES. What's up, guys? It's time for day number two of the GSL CODES round of 32. We had an awesome day number one. A laser, unfortunately, did not advance, but we have another non-Korean here today. Scarlet back again to fight and move on to the round of 16.
It's her third time. Maybe that third time's a charm for her. I'm hoping that she can make it through, and I think she definitely can through this group, but I gotta tell you, those interviews were pretty funny and pretty telling. You know, Ryung, Hurricane, and Scarlet all saying, damn, this group's really hard. This is a tough one. We'll see how it goes. I've tried really hard. I think I can do it. And then Invasion's like, oh, this group is easy. I'm gonna get through smoothly. It's like, oh my God.
Innovation, kind of always the same guy, whether he's won or lost. Doesn't give the greatest interviews, but in a sense, you can see the confidence that he has, and in some ways, the indifference to who he's up against.
Yeah.
By the attitude that he shows.
Well, he just won VSL last night. This guy is probably, I don't know what to say. He's like the most consistent top-end player. In fact, I was thinking about this morning while I was watching the Sue VODs yesterday.
Yeah.
From yesterday, the VSL Finals, where he 4-0'd Sue guys. Of course, it was a final, so yeah, Sue was meant to lose. But innovation, tell me if you agree with this.
Okay, go ahead.
Innovation has the highest base skill set in StarCraft II.
I think I can stand behind that one. The way I look at Innovation is he is... If you had to explain to somebody what a really, really good pro gamer looks like in StarCraft,
yeah,
you could point to a lot of players, but the easiest one to point to is Innovation. Mm-hmm. He is everything that we understand about RTS,
yeah,
put into one package. Now, does he do the craziest strats? No, not really. Does he win necessarily with the best micro? No, he just kind of does everything right.
Yeah.
Or I guess you could say everything perfectly.
Yeah.
And as the game goes on for longer, he's always further and further ahead.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that's why a lot of people who are studying to become better players in StarCraft II, for instance, look up to him.
Totally. He's got the best basics of anyone, I would say. Like, you drop him out of the helicopter, and he has no idea what the current metagame is, he's going to fare better than anyone else, I think. You know, he's just like...
Yeah.
He's mechanically just all there. He's just, like, always a force for
and
everyone
he's always through. Picking a build that's basically safe to use on any map.
Yeah.
Where if he's faster and stronger, he'll probably overcome his opponent.
Totally. But, yeah. I think he's probably going to get out tonight. But these other guys, very, very strong. Things can go wrong for Innovation. Recently, his TBT has had kind of a rough time. Brown, one of the best TBT players in the world.
Absolutely.
We can see here that in VSL, just recently, Innovation did 3-0 Hurricane. But Hurricane has pretty good TBT overall, so maybe he could knock Inno down. And, of course, Scarlet is in probably her top form really ever right now.
Scarlet had a bumpy ride last time we saw her in the GSL CODES. She played some very good games but had some very big misses within those series. So it was a real up and down day for her. But I think she should have a little bit more refined playstyle coming in here today. So much of being a top player, especially in a tournament as competitive as the GSL CODES, the most competitive tournament in the world for StarCraft II, is you have to keep in mind that experience is everything. You come down here so many times, like for instance Gumiho has, well, he's been in 18 or 17 GSL CODESs,
yeah.
And when you have that much experience, just being here in the booth, playing in front of a live audience and playing with that much pressure on you, because winning a GSL CODES, that is the most sought after thing to win as far as Korean StarCraft goes.
Well, I would say, you know, BlizzCon and CODES, that's like the two things where you win either of those and you are a legend for all time. I mean, who doesn't think about Sniper and Seed all the time? no, but seriously, this is the tournament. You want to be the best player in the world? Like, truly consider that? You must win GSL.
That's right. So, starting this off, it's going to be Ryung versus Hurricane. Ryung is a household name if you've been following the GSL since the early days.
12 CODESs.
12 CODESs, which is crazy. This guy is very solid. He seems to, especially in the early part of 2017, been in the best shape he's ever been in.
Yeah.
Ever.
True.
Definitely dominated in TBT. Hurricane is, in some ways, the everyman of the GSL CODES players. He's somebody who is strong, is good, has had some great games, but does not seem to be able to break through that membrane and get deep into a GSL CODES.
You're definitely right. The
underdog.
I kind of agree with you on all those points, Tasteless. He's always spoken well of by the other Korean pros. There's been times where they've said he might even be the best ProDOS, but he hasn't shown it yet.
Well, now's his chance. Get ready, guys. We are going into our first best of three, Ryung versus Hurricane, in today's GSL CODES. In the bottom right, in the blue, originally mentored by Slayer's Boxer, 7 years later here in the GSL CODES. We are being brought Coca-Cola.
Oh, wow.
That's really... That's never happened before, ever.
No,
why?
That's...
That... I don't even know what to say.
Maybe it's another pizza day. I don't know.
Do we get pizza down here? Is there pizza?
I don't know what's going on, man. Maybe
somebody,
burgers or something?
Somebody from the staff just brought us soda, and that's just...
With cups of ice.
Oh, careful.
Nice?
Don't let it fizz up, man.
Is there a rat
don't
around here that needs
some cooling?
Spill
it on your nice caster shirt.
Because I could pour some ice onto it.
Yeah, we need to have an ice machine up here.
That would be nice. There's yours. Here's mine. How you doing, by the way, Tasteless?
I'm doing good.
Yeah? Guys at home?
I've been super excited about today. Actually, I could hardly sleep last night. I was pumped because the last time we had Scarlet playing, in a GSL, people were going nuts.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And, it, like, it, here's the thing. This is her third season, right? And both those other seasons, she did well. She played well.
Yeah.
She took some great games and played some great games. And she's, no regret, keeps telling us, she's been practicing her ass off. So this could be the moment where we see her actually get through into that round of 16. And it has been just forever since we've had a foreigner get through the round of 32. And it would be fitting for it to be Scarlett.
Interesting scouting pattern here with the SCV in the bottom left. It seems like he might park that over there, at least for the time being, rather than just going right towards Hurricane's base.
Yeah, this is kind of funny because Hurricane is one basing a little bit here, like
probably
a mothership core into a Oracle. You know, it's a very popular opening, and to have Ryung go for a proxy, which he does this a lot in TVP. He's very kind of aggressive. And I mean, I don't know if I really want to call this specifically a cheese because you can definitely get into a macro game. But like, if you proxy a factory in a starport, you can do some pretty dastardly things against Stargate openings because the detection is not permanent.
I like what you said back there, Artosis, because I think this is something we don't really highlight that much, is that a lot of times people will see a building being made perhaps in close proximity to the other player's main and assume that that means a cheese are all in. And it, not necessarily at all.
No.
I mean, this just might be an attempt, for instance, in this case, let's say he gets a Banshee or something, flies in there and starts taking out workers. That's not an all-in. That's just a pretty sneaky way to completely throw off the other player. And if they're not prepared for it, they get punished hard. If it doesn't work out, you can still get your stuff back home.
Yes, it's very true. Now, look at exactly what Ryung's doing. This is made to counter starport openings.
Because he's going to go for Widow Mines? Oracle.
Yeah, like, and he's even going for the reactor, right? So like, he'll have less Widow Mines right in the beginning, but then he'll have way more Widow Mines. And all you have to do is spread those, and Oracles cannot keep up with that detection.
Yeah, on the surface, it might look like the Oracle would immediately counter the Widow Mines, right? But yeah, they don't have the energy that can keep up with the number of Widow Mines that would be burrowing down there. It would basically completely counter what the other player's doing. And it's a great way to punish them, especially because a lot of Protosses really do rely on the Oracle early on as a fix-all.
Yeah.
And it is a fix-all to a certain extent, but not if you start to snowball Widow Mines in there. They can't really get a proper response.
Yeah, things can get very, very dirty at that point. Now, look at this. The Oracle comes in, and of course, if you build your buildings across the map, this can happen. So this is a ton of damage, but this doesn't mean that Hurricane straight wins. A lot of times, that's exactly what it would mean if all your tech was at home. But you get some Widow Mines spread out over in Hurricane's base, and things can go wrong.
Yeah. Now, the Oracle not being there is going to be harmful when the Widow Mines come in, but Terran seems to have denied the rest of this rush from coming in here and doing too much more damage. But you have to wonder if Hurricane's going to be a little bit suspicious. Why is there not more back there at the Terran base to defend? And that has been answered right here, right now. Six kills.
Huge. That was a huge Widow Mine hit. And now he's got two spread out, right? A Robo has been started. So when that gets out and he gets an Observer, he can finally clean this all up. But that is a lot of probes you're losing, a lot of lost mining time you're losing as well.
I have to say I'm a bit surprised he was not ready for the Widow Mine drop, at least as far as transferring probes right away.
Yes, yes.
Because that's exactly the time when it's going to come in, every time.
Well, yeah, if it's proxy like this, and the thing is, if you get to their base and they don't...
Oh my God,
that's a huge one. I'm kind of shocked. Like, every Protoss worth their salt knows exactly when that Widow Mine's coming back up.
And the medevac gets away.
Oh, my God.
Whoa.
Ooh, you know, it just might be that his multitasking is being a little bit taxed right now. You know, so much stuff is going wrong.
Additional kills here. You can see he's picking up and then burrowing back down the Widow Mine. Looks like he will be able to take out that one medevac that's trying to retreat. But it doesn't appear that Ryung is done yet. He's actually got Marines rallying up right now. He's got his two Cyclones gearing up to try to pick a fight with his opponent.
Yeah, adding in a few Cyclones here is really cool. Oh, my God, I can't believe he didn't repair that back at home. Oh,
that was the one that got away earlier when the Phoenix wasn't right-clicked on it.
Came right back as a donation to die there. But look at this. With four Cyclones, two more on the way? Oh, geez, this is really, really strong.
Yeah, the crippling maneuver that happened earlier on may allow Terran to come in here and just stomp the Protoss out of this game, and we'll have to go on to the second game coming up here. As Ryung is really... Yeah, to be honest, Drunk's played like this before, but it's definitely working brilliantly here against Hurricane.
It is indeed. Now, this push is scary, but he has an Immortal on the way. He's got three Oracles. He's got three Gateways in this pylon out front, a nice Stasis Ward. Looks like he should be able to live through this attack from Ryung.
Okay, Ryung is trying to get into position. He wants to see if he can't trigger anything, and he does. Now, he's going to try to milk the energy from the pylons here. I think he might be right, Artosis. I think it's possible that Hurricane should just have enough for
yeah.
the time being.
The Cyclone is a really funny unit against Protoss. If you're not ready for it, it can just kill you straight up. But as soon as you like realize that there's actually Cyclones coming, you can do a setup like this where it's like, ooh, yeah, they're good, but they're not breaking an Immortal and Photon overcharges.
It is quite interesting to see how the Cyclone has evolved its role since it was first introduced in StarCraft II. Mm-hmm. It was initially kind of not used, then used in this funny way, like you'd get one of them to kind of hold off everything, and then people started doing a few rushes where you get one to two of them, or maybe three, and now we've seen that, you know, with Gumiho, oh no, you could just make a bunch of Cyclones early on, and it's a completely viable unit.
And really, Ryung is a similar flavor of Terran in a lot of ways to Gumiho.
I
can't make it too close to them, but anyways. I mean, it's kind of interesting now, though, because the Cyclones don't really scale very well.
That's true.
Really, like, I guess we see some funny games where Gumiho plays against Zerg or something where they still do some stuff later game, but against Protoss, I've never really seen them used effectively past this point.
Well, I think it's diminishing returns, but it is interesting to see how handy people have... made them become in these funny positions, especially against the Stargate openers from the Protoss.
Yeah.
It seems to be a very good direct response to Stargate, whether it's defensive or offensive, at least early on, which is pretty cool. As far as Protoss goes in this game, we have Colossi coming out now. Thermal Lance is on the way. Terran does scan and see that the third base Nexus is almost done. We'll find out if this is going to trigger in any way the Terran to try to move out and punish this.
He does have his third command center, so whether he gets to punish it or not, I don't think is going to be the top thing here. Like, I don't imagine he can do too much damage because that army is not really that scary at this point. But actually, if I could just say one more thing about the Cyclone, because it's been really interesting kind of hashing out with you. It reminds me a lot, the design of the Cyclone, the more I think about it, because the original design that it got nerfed from, right, where it could lock on from a trillion miles away and kill everything by itself, not that design, but the design we have right now, it kind of reminds me of StarCraft 1 a little bit, where it's like, whoever does better here is going to win. Like, the Cyclone doesn't super hard counter anything, but, like, if you use it well, it's going to work out well, and then, like, if your opponent does stuff well, it's not going to work. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, it's something that it does come down to the user's ability.
Yeah.
And how strong are they with this specific unit?
Yeah, like, are they going to make the right strategic
moves? You look like
moves?
An Immortal, right? And we don't normally say, this guy's really good with Immortals, right? The Immortal, it's just, if it's there, it does what it's
Put
supposed to do.
Put it in your control group. It's a good unit.
Yeah, and it'll figure it out for you, whereas the Cyclone is very much a matter of, like, okay, can you actually use this correctly?
Do you know where to pick your fight with the Cyclone?
Okay, a Hurricane getting a little bit sloppy here. Taking some additional damage there, losing one Phoenix, the other Oracle, I believe. It should be a little bit of the damage past the shields here. But he wants to be careful with that. It's very important that you have that air army ready to help defend if a big attack happens. And that attack might be happening right now. It's actually 163 supply to 133. This does not seem to be a bad moment for Terran to try to move out and actually initiate something on the map, especially by pushing that air army back. The Liberators are going to be a pretty big threat.
Yeah, that's really the one scary thing here for Hurricane. Other than those Liberators, he should be fine against everything, but the Liberators themselves can really push everything back. So good thing that he's tagging it and just kind of staying on top of this army, making sure that it stays zoned out, because if you get set up with the Liberators, that becomes a very tough fight for Protoss.
Well, That's when Terran can actually dig his heels in and basically force the Protoss to either deal with it or back off. Hold up. Okay, we have the Liberation Zones going down, and now Phoenix is picking up. The Liberators remain in the air right now. These Marines still staying in the front. The Liberators on the ground continue to do damage. Colossi here in the back is the one thing that's holding this army together. Can he actually gun it down?
Oh, wow. A big commitment there to get rid of it. The Photon Overcharge doing extra damage. In the meantime, a counter harassment doing a good job. Stalker's blinking over now, getting rid of some of these Liberators. But really, these Liberators are everything here for Ryung.
Okay, the Immortal does go down, and this means that the Stalkers and the Colossi are completely cut off from the third base and soon to be fourth base. However, Ryung has to get reinforcements up here and right away if he's going to be able to push down through this area and break this. But there's no way for Stalkers to get underneath these Liberators.
It's so hard. Like, you can't blink under that right now, or the Widowmines and the Bio just kill you. So he's got a Disruptor. That definitely, you can do some tricks with that, but oh my god.
Actually, I think if Hurricane doesn't come up with something very quickly, I think this game ends right away. I think Ryung just wins.
Well, with those extra two Liberators coming over, this doesn't look breakable to me.
He's made the Venn diagram of hell right there on that bridge.
Look at that little middle part, that little oval.
That's where everything overlaps.
Hundreds of damage!
He tries to come in. Good pullback here against the Disruptor. The Disruptor's going to take a little while. Before that cooldown is going to complete, and he can then try to engage that again. But while this is going on, just south of our screenshot here, we have a shot of it now. The Nexus is taking damage, and this is all Ryung has to do. Ryung is already setting himself up for a big possible win here.
Now, this is a really great move. Now, he's picked off some of these Liberators. Ooh, a missed Disruptor hit once again. Still has that Colossus helping him to deal damage. And really great upgrades on the way for Hurricane, but he's just sitting here trying to warp in Stalkers, trying to stay alive.
All right, we have more Liberators. I think two more about to come up and meet up with the rest of this army. He's going for the Colossus. So far, decent kiting. It remains in the game. Can he get that last shot off? He does. I think there's just too much tearing everything here. Yeah. This game is starting to snowball. Meanwhile, the bottom expansion over here is about to be destroyed. There it is. GG. A 2-0 win. Ryan. Oh. I wasn't even trying to be funny, but I ended up slurring Wynn and Ryung together. Ryung wins 2-0 in an impressive showing, completely dominating Hurricane. Hurricane, I think, is going to have a tough time in this group, especially with games like that. If that's any indicator of what the rest of this is going to look like today from him, he should be knocked out first, I think.
I can't argue with what you said there. Ryung did kind of catch him off guard, especially that first mind drop. That really, like, when you lose six probes to a mind drop that's that quick, that's hard to recover from. I like some of the harassment he did and stuff, but I guess there was too much going on to really go over this point. But when the Oracle gets to their base and there's not like either a Cyclone locking on or a Widowmine that they're running their SCVs away to, you gotta know that's a proxy factory.
Yeah.
And if you know it's a proxy factory, you better be looking at your mineral line.
Well, that's what's strange about it. It almost seemed like Hurricane had no idea what was coming at him in that game, right? And that's something Ryung's done a decent amount. It's pretty trendy. And of course, when you get there with the Oracle and Adept, you kind of own the Terran. You're kind of manhandling them.
Yeah.
You have to say, well, where are the rest of his units?
Exactly.
Boom, it's a proxy. The rush had ended there from Hurricane, and yet he still wasn't prepared when that medevac came in there.
And you know what? One other thing, Tasteless. He scouted for the proxy, but it was just a bit too far away.
Yeah.
So I understand that, right? You scout, you're like, there's no way he's bad enough to put it that far away, but it works out sometimes. You can ride, you can fly, you can tell them that you tried, but there ain't no going back.
All right, here in the bottom right, winning game number one.
Ryung.
This is really important for him to win this match, by the way.
Yeah. In the upper left, in the red, he is
Hurricane.
So, I think Ryung is going to feel most confident, perhaps, even, going up against Innovation, as crazy as that sounds, because he does have such strong TBT.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, disproportionately strong for his matchups.
Well, he's actually always had really, really good Terran vs. Terran since the early days. And
I remember it was like everyone talked about like MMA and MVP and stuff, but it was like, well, Ryung was as good or better than them at TBT.
Yeah, well, Ryung's a player who has had somewhat of a lopsided past with success rates in certain matchups. Like TBT, for instance, he's like a Terran killer.
Mm-hmm.
If you got a team match and you have to have somebody play against another Terran, you'd send Ryung out.
Exactly.
But Ryung has not always showed the most well-rounded play in all the other matchups as well. So, I mean, in some ways, if Ryung can win here and then let's assume for Ryung's sake that Scarlet then loses to Innovation, then I think Ryung can actually get out of this group.
Totally. And in fact, even if Scarlet won there, it's like, if Ryung goes a loser match, I don't think he can get out of the group. I don't think that'll work out right for him.
You know, to be honest, in some ways, that last game we saw, it almost felt like that was a 2-0.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Because we had the initial part where the Widowmines got and did so much damage. Mm. And then from there, the follow-ups, you could just see there was no way that Hurricane was able to hang on against Ryung back there. So I'm worried Hurricane might be in pretty bad shape going into game number two. Try not to psychoanalyze too much, but that was a pretty rough game.
Well, I think that you're right in a way to psychoanalyze, because we've heard from many, many pro gamers. Like, Hurricane is highly respected.
Right.
He's almost like a more successful Younghwa, right? Where it's like everyone thinks that Hurricane is a very strong player. Everyone always expects him to do well, then he never does, right? So in situations like that, you just got to ask, like, is this guy's mentality something that's easily broken? Is he just not able to do this under pressure in a GSL?
You've got to ask yourself that question, what is going on here? Mm. If everybody's claiming you're good, yet when you have a big match like this, you not even like you did the wrong strategy, but you're not even physically responding in time when there's real engages occurring. I think you have to say maybe this person's head really isn't in the game like it should be when it matters the most.
Well, when you're a StarCraft pro and you love StarCraft to death, you're a really good player or something, you can definitely stress out when you're on the biggest stage.
Absolutely.
I've seen that happen to a lot of players in the past.
It's really interesting to see how people compute these situations differently. Mm. Some people, they have a big match against, let's say they have a big match on a stage against somebody who is viewed as better than them. Some people will get nervous. Other people get excited.
Yes.
You know?
It is. Yeah, right? And, like, you can definitely tell a lot of differences. Like, for instance, I think SOS is one of the best examples of someone who is going to play better the more important the match is.
Yeah, I think so.
It's like you put SOS, like, in... Okay, look, Innovation, generally, I would have him defend the human race, you would think. But it's like, no, if aliens come and we need someone to beat them, you send out SOS, because even with all that pressure, I think he'll do fine.
Well, it depends on what kind of aliens are attacking Artosis. If it's like aliens from the second Aliens movie, then you want Innovation.
Okay.
If it's the Independence Day aliens, then you want SOS.
The Independence Day aliens, you think? Because they have shields like Protoss?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Yeah, I thought that's why you were saying that.
So the SOS can put a virus on their computer software.
But if it's the alien
aliens,
don't you want to send in Maynard? Because he looks like Predator?
Oh, Maynard does look like the Predator for sure.
These questions, they're the important ones.
Well, a lot of times when you look at like a really good Protoss player, like SOS, I imagine that he is the Predator down here to hunt other nerds.
Yeah. Well, Tasteless, this is a really, really fast third command center coming out of Ryung. Reasonably safe. And it looks like just a very fast third base coming out of Hurricane to respond to that, getting his tech up rather quickly as well. So that's a good response, I would say, overall.
Sure. We have the Phoenix out here hoping to catch anything that might try to come in here medevac-wise if a drop does occur. Protoss is getting adepts, and it looks like more Phoenixes are going to continue to be added in here. As for the time being, Hurricane's really going for a unit composition that's going to give him a lot of momentum and respect in the mid-game. Mm-hmm. We'll see how long he stays on, for instance, Phoenix Adept here, or if he just tries to transition steadily out of that into a higher tech.
Well, you know, Phoenix Adept, I mean, that's definitely a strategy that I think everyone, including us, has talked into the ground. But realistically, I don't like Phoenix Adept against this as much. I hope that he transitions really quickly, because, like, if Ryung just turtles on three bases and
that's
then
all
moves
you have
out, Phoenix Adept is not going to do anything. It's like, he needs to get into Colossus really quickly after this.
It was quite interesting when we saw Phoenix Adept initially come into the meta and trouble Terran so much. Mm. But a lot of those Terrans were still moving out with medevacs and dropping everywhere. And, of course, the Phoenixes just kill the dropship, and then the Adepts win the fight on the ground. But the real answer to that style of play is to just not attack. You just stay back.
Like, you have to turtle.
You make stuff. Mm. You play single player. And then later on, you have a better army when you push out.
Well, it looks to me like Hurricane may be just doing a huge, huge attack with plus one and glaives, right? Because he's got a pylon that he's already proxied. He's going up to a lot of gateways right now, continually making these Phoenixes. So we might see him pull the trigger and go in.
We'll see if Ryung spots this. There is a certain factor you have to keep in mind, is a lot of times if you lose a game like you lost in game one, where you didn't seem to be that ready and it seemed like the other player just was more prepared, I think if the losing player is much more likely to cheese or all in the second game if he's not feeling confident. Mm. So this may be a response to game one more so than the map itself.
Could be. It looks like, okay, he's going into Blink and continuing to make Phoenixes here. Doesn't look like he's actually going to drop the army. Even got the gases number 5 and 6, right? So that generally means you're not going to be attacking. But I feel like he has to go into Colossus Tech this second. Like, he cannot be waiting. Like, it takes a while to actually get Colossus out with Thermal Lance, and if he doesn't have that, when Ryung actually is sitting up like 120 spy, he's in trouble. And okay, he throws down Colossus Tech, so that's really important.
Blink is about one third of the way complete here. We also have the Warp Prison being made. While the Robo Colossus Tech is coming up here, Terran, on the other hand, is just steadily teching up to everything that he needs, getting now Liberators into the fray, deeming that he has enough medevacs for the time being. There's no need to make any more. And also, Terran really respecting the map control that Protoss has had for a little while here. Yeah. He's just staying back.
It's very well played by Ryung. I'm really a fan of how he's doing this, right? He's just adding complexity and he's turtling. He's not going to move out. He sees Phoenix is in Adepts. He knows what will happen. So this is I feel like he's getting himself into a good position, but it's not like Hurricane is playing poorly here. He's going into double Robo Colossus, taking his fourth base, and we're going to have a really big clash that is very likely to be determined by how these Liberators do. And he's going into Liberator range. I love it. I love it.
Well, how many Phoenixes does he have right now? Is it four?
Yeah, like three or four.
I think if he has enough Liberators out, and the Stalkers can't get in a good position, the Terran should just win the fight.
Yeah, yeah, and especially as he's going into Liberator range, that's going to give him like a huge bonus.
That and Widowmine's coming in here with this army as well. I mean, what is it, four Liberators with this army right now?
I think so,
I believe it is, to four Phoenixes, and that's just not enough. Oh, hold on. Can he actually get this Warp Prism here as well? Now, see, this is a completely stifled harass.
Yeah,
it's just
painful.
Three Adepts, which means that the Liberators can actually then reinforce after this attack. And I don't believe Protoss has any other Warp Prism. So at this point in time, okay, hold up. He's moving out here. There's nothing to defend.
Yeah, fourth base is going to insta-fall here. You can't really do anything against it. Liberator range isn't started quite yet. I think that's what that tech lab on the production tab is going to be. But even just killing the space,
oh my god, where'd they go? vaporized Artosis.
They certainly did, Tasis.
Where did David Copperfield make all those Phoenixes go, Artosis?
David Kimmerfield, more like it.
Wow.
He's made those
7 years of this, and we hadn't made a joke like that.
No, that's brand new.
And losing the Phoenixes like that, it takes the wind entirely out of the sails here for Protoss. Terran can really just sort of do what he wants. Let's see if he can connect on top of those
Widowmines. Ooh, sickest hit.
That was a great connect. Is it going to be enough, though? Does Terran already have too much leg room right now to deny expansions that Protoss needs to get very badly?
Ooh, he actually let those shade through. This is the really hard part, is engaging into the Liberators. But he's making everything chase these Adepts. I feel like this is the one time he can actually break the Liberators. Yeah, and in fact, he's walking around right now trying to do it.
Trying to edge in here. The Liberators just completely reposition, and there's a lot of Stalkers taking too much damage over in this location.
A little bit messy. I think he was being a little bit too greedy trying to clear the Liberators too cost-efficiently. I think if you get the army to actually chase the Adepts, just barrel in there, kill the Liberators, and reset that position.
It seems like Protoss is losing too many little chunks of units here and there.
Yeah.
I don't know if Hurricane's ever going to have the necessary unit composition to actually just have a fight that he can win. Ryung is actually on the run right now, while Terran is looking like he wants to possibly move this big drop up here and try to land it. I don't know, man. I'm a little bit worried here for Hurricane. He's just not having anything that he makes when it comes to getting into a fight. He's losing it.
It's especially going to be hard because Liberator range is about to finish. And the thing is, he has like a lot of splash, two Colossus and a ton of Disruptors here. Disruptors are not guaranteed, though. They're very good. But to break a bunch of ranged Liberators, that's going to be hard. Disruptors are kind of like slow, similar to Liberators in that way, right? You're not totally mobile with this force, so I don't know, man. I really like where Ryung's at, sitting here on four bases with this type of tech.
Okay, War Prism headed down now, over here through the bottom. Let's see if there's anything there to try to catch that. Meanwhile, a big drop. Ooh. It is spotted. There by that Observer. He's going to come in now.
Oh, my God. If he boosts right now into this.
Oh, my God. All right. Good scan. Yeah. Good save.
If he had flown that in, that would have been a game changer right there.
Oh, absolutely.
40 supply down the tubes. But now they're both maxed out. Still the better comp. Definitely going to be going to Ryung as long as Disruptors don't get insane value hits. And Tempest Tech is on the way, but is that going to be too slow?
Okay. Taryn is privy to the fact that there's a war prison moving around there. With the setup of these Liberators, I'm wondering, he actually could just run up here.
This is, I guess for the bio to move forward, it's a little bit difficult. Oh my god, the medevac's coming back in here. This is a really good drop.
Okay, Protoss is coming back now to try to push this back inside the medevacs. He is going to pick up. He does lose one medevac there, but of course he can relocate somewhere else. And the small number of adepts that are coming here to counterattack are so little that the units that are coming out of the barracks immediately can actually take them on head on.
Again, we're like, where does Hurricane go from here? He's so boxed in. Complete control this game for Ryung. Has his medevacs all over the place, hitting multiple locations, and there's such a big no man's land due to the Liberators. Oh my god.
Okay, as you can see, he's going to be able to get this Nexus. The Disruptors cannot dislodge the defensive position here that Ryung has, and that's going to be one Nexus that goes down, and I think with this many Liberators and the fact that most of this army is not able to comfortably move to try to engage certain locations, Taryn can continue to chop up the position of the armies here and keep winning fights.
Yeah, he's killing off so much of the economy as well. The Tempest, you need the Tempest to clear those Liberators. It's just impossible to attack into there.
Now, this could be a huge warping over here. Well, assuming he does it.
He's actually supply capped. Lost too many pylons.
That's actually a good point, yeah. I would have missed that. Good call on that, Artosis.
Don't worry, he's losing a lot of units now.
The fact that he had already lost so many pylons that were set up in defensive positions means that, yeah, I mean, of course the Terran can just stem in and start to take out these additional bases. And look at this, a fight right underneath this. Just going for these Disruptors. I love it!
Yeah, just offensively going after the army here. And Hurricane is just kind of falling apart everywhere on the map right now. This is really, really rough. Ryung has secured this game. There's no possibility of him losing from here.
And look at how safe Ryung is.
Yeah.
He's just staying back.
He doesn't need the killing glow.
The only real way that a player could beat me at this point in time is if I messed up with my main army. So he's just going to keep it all together. He's going to come down here with everything, chase this into a corner of the map, and stamp it out.
Woo. That's it.
Woo. Woo.
Disruptors are fun. But yeah, it's like, I guess Hurricane moves out and does his final attack because he still has a really strong army. But Ranged Liberator is pretty good against this.
Yeah, there's no way that Protoss with a clunky army like this, even with the Tempest there that outranged the Liberators, I mean, Taryn can keep making units underneath that and be fine.
He's got, like, way too much. It's too slow to kill everything with two Tempests at this point. And Hurricane sitting here with just 30 probes, barely mining. And Tempest being chased down, I mean.
Looks like one Tempest will go down. Of course, Ryung then backs up to regroup, getting it to a defensive position. We have the Nexus being remade right now here for Hurricane as he's trying to stabilize back in this game once again.
A bunch of Marauders going to come in and wipe this out. At this point,
I think it's going to be GG here.
I mean, yeah, you don't want to leave as Hurricane because you still have, like, units and crazy things happen, but crazy things are not going to happen against this guy that's been in GSL 12 times. He is going to finish this game off for sure.
Okay, he's escaping now down here through the south. Meanwhile, there's enough Liberators that he can actually face the Tempest head on.
Don't see that every day.
Well, this is a pretty sick surround here.
Yeah.
Every angle you ever knew about that ever existed.
It's like flanking from Ana and Kata even.
Flanking from other maps that we can't even see here, other planets.
There's a different time he's flanking from as well.
Okay. Good defensive setup here. At this point in time, Ryung knows all he has to do is, like, run the clock out, if you will.
Yeah.
There's no way the Hurricane has enough minerals coming in, enough gas coming in to make anything sustainable. Where you see that for Ryung, his supply is almost to the max out limit. He's got a lot of gas. Yeah. That's fine. He's just burning his minerals and any extra gas he has to have the right unit comp to just counter this. And in this case, he's going to make four Vikings.
Yeah, just pumping out the Vikings makes a lot of sense. If he kills the air stuff, that's the end of the game. This is basically the entire economy of Hurricane right now, which is just... It pales in comparison to what Ryung has mining at the moment.
Okay, as the game goes on, Tempest has been driven back here. I gotta say, okay, there it is, GG. I was gonna say, I don't know what else Hurricane's looking for, because Ryung basically won that, and he didn't necessarily try to go in there and wipe him out. He just said, okay, you're dead. I'm going to go back. I'm going to play defensive. Yeah. anything you throw at me, I'm going to have an answer for, and I'm going to win from there.
Yeah, this was, like, all correct decisions from Ryung, in my opinion. Like, he knew 100% he had that game for a very long time.
Yeah.
As long as he just did what he did, which is pull back, make units. And, like, you can have a more flashy victory or you just force a win, maybe. But it's like, this is... I would rather see the 100%, right? Or the 99.99% rather than 95%.
Well, I think sometimes you'll have a player, even at the highest level, that gets excited and says, I'm owning him so hard, I'm going to get the rest of my army in here. I'll probably win them with this attack. You go in and you go for it. When what he does, he just stays back and waits for the war prisms to come, guns that down, gets more ahead.
I subscribe to that style. When you're ahead, get more ahead. Let your opponent leave the game.
We'll be right back with Scarlet versus Innovation after this short break.
Switch up my style, I take any lane. I switch up my cup, I kill any pain.